Okay, so the left elephant is the base elephant, and that's where the story started. So, Luke, can you give some information, like what was base in the beginning of the story, so 2014?
Yeah, indeed, that's already a couple of years ago. Base was, in fact, base company, as we called, was third operator, mobile operator in Belgium, and we were 100% owned by KPN. In the meantime, base company is bought by Telenet, which is Telenet owned by Liberty Global for a part. How we were a couple of years ago organized, we were a very big technology department, and the technology department was responsible for an maintenance and innovation on the mobile network, as also the IT innovation. So it was in fact led by CTO, Chief Technology Officer. We didn't have a CIO. He was responsible for mobile network and responsible for IT. This technology department consisted of a number of a couple of hundred people. And if you go specific into the IT organization, then our main integration partner, which we worked together for all IT innovations, was an Indian company. We worked in a very traditional way at that time, with a fixed price contract for all projects and KPIs with penalties. Very traditionally, a part was done offshore, a part was done onshore. In IT, we were also organized very traditionally in technology silos. The mindset, the culture was one of a lot of escalation. So escalations went up to the CTO and then came back down to us, where we then escalated to our partner to put more pressure to get the things done. So this was the environment where we worked in. And then at a certain moment, we changed CTO. A new CTO came, Suzanne Kelder from KPN. And this was the moment that, in fact, things started to change, because we wanted to do things, or she wanted to do things in another way.
And that's when you decided, okay, let's try something more agile, somewhere around summertime 2014. And then I still remember, I think September or October 2014, we came to this initial talk with you. And the first thing that we asked is like, okay, why do you want agile? So what were the main goals of actually trying agile? So we didn't just say, okay, let's do agile. It was like, okay, there must be good reason. And then we were thinking about really supporting you in getting there. So what were those reasons?
Well, the first goal was time to market, of course, because we are in a changing environment. Our time to market at that time for very large projects was 52 weeks, so nearly 1 year, where half was discussing about the scope and the other half was implementing the scope. And we needed to reduce that considerably. Our aim was, let's go, to start with, let's go to 35 weeks. That would be already good for large projects.
And that's something you achieved after a bit more than a year. So if I still remember the metrics.
Correct.
So this was priority number one, because you also had to prioritize your goal settings. It's not all important. So this was number one. What was number two?
Well, number two was our business agility, because we were in a very, or we are still in a very competitive environment. We were the third mobile operator, and we are also a mobile-centric operator. So we didn't have at that time internet or fixed lines, or and since we needed to change very quickly and adapt ourselves in this competitive environment, we want to be able to change our plans very quickly. So our first idea was, let's put our big projects in smaller blocks and let's use backlogs to prioritize these smaller blocks instead of using escalations to try to push to get work quicker done.
So you really didn't want the escalation as we see it now on the presentation. And so it was like, we need to stop fighting the situations reactively. We need to be more proactive. That's great. So we had the first priority, having time to market. The second one, business agility, pretty much linked to each other. And I still remember that the third priority was cost related. And either we lost Luke. I think we lost Luke in the meantime. So Alexander, I leave it to you to get Luke back in, and in the meantime, I will give some input on the cost.
Yes. So
when we discussed going agile and what will we do and not do, we went into the need priorities. What are the goals of actually trying out agile next to the previously mentioned two? Cost was also in the picture. So they wanted cost reduction in, as well. Then again, if we look through the years of doing the agile adoption, there is Luke again. There was change in the cost itself. So the cost was not really going down. But Luke, please give your input on the cost perspective.
Yeah, on the cost. Yeah, sorry for the interruption, but everything was blocked here on my side. For the cost, yeah, well, our budget was more or less the same. There was not that there was a big pressure on the cost. However, it was clear that they wanted to do more with the same amount of money.
So we had three goals, which were clearly identified, clearly prioritized. And then we understood Agile might indeed help out to achieve some of the goals that were set forward. So what approach did we go for initially, Luke? Do you still remember?
Yeah, well, there were two options that we thought about, because to be honest, I didn't know anything about Agile at that time. So I didn't know anything about any framework. I know that currently I know there are a lot of frameworks, but we said, we can do two things. Or we start and take a project and try to improve that project in a more agile way of working, or we focus on a specific area, a complete area, and we do there a disruptive change and change this complete area into a more agile way of working.
So you really went into two different directions. Agile, the famous agile projects and more of a domain-oriented one. So, which is cool. So if you don't know what it is, you can indeed start experimenting two different ways. So at the end, you did this and you measured in order to see, what would be best fit for your organization. Which one did you choose at the end and why?
Well, at the end, we did both, but one was more successful than the other. We chose more an area which has not too much dependencies with other areas. That was for us the data warehouse, business intelligence domain, because they were less impacted by other domains. And we transformed and did a proof of concept in this complete area. We changed towards agile methodology. Of course, for the it is a small block that the rest of the organization was still working in the traditional way. So we build a kind of interface towards the rest of the organization. So in this independent area, we did a complete transfer. That means from one day to the other, after some training, they didn't work in projects anymore, but we created the complete in this Scrum process. We learned then how to do Scrum, and we changed from one day to another towards a more Scrum approach for BI. At the end of the pilot, that after a couple of months, I think 4 months was it, we did a survey. A survey internally, the people who did, who changed their methodology, but also towards the customers. And if you look to the slides, we had in fact fantastic results, because 92% they don't want to go back to the previous methodology. The people thought, yeah, the quality is indeed improved a lot. We can much better handle change, 92% there. We have a much better visibility, and our productivity increased. If you look to the figures, 92%, it's quite, in fact, it's fantastic results. Of course, this results was for this domain only. This data warehouse domain.
Yeah, but those results went up into the chain of command, let's say. So also C-level came into contact, like, okay, with those results and the recommendations from the people in and surrounding the proof of concepts. So and that's when this Bolt 1.0 came into the picture.
Yeah, and what was Bolt 1.0? In fact, now I understand that they prepared already for a takeover. So the whole company needed to reorganize. And our CTO, she took the chance to also already go in the direction of the complete IT organization changing towards an agile adoption. Of course, that was a little bit not what we wanted, in fact, because we had just done one small domain. And in fact, the next step was for us, we take the next domain and transform it. But with this Bolt 1.0, suddenly she created all the domains and everybody needed to change at once. Which is of course very chaotical, and it was not area per area, but the whole organization. Luckily, we had already kind of blueprint ready, and this blueprint was based on, in the telecom, it's called the ETOM standard, where you define already business areas according to business processes, so outcome-oriented areas. And the reorganization was in line with this ETOM standard. So she flipped the whole organization around at once. Very chaotic, I must say.
We were a bit taken by speed. So in this scenario, we were too slow. We were still identifying the areas and how to flip the areas. And suddenly it was just announced, like, we do the complete organization. So very chaotic. Then again, also a fun period during the change, I guess. You mentioned in the beginning as well that you had a large integration partner. So also there you had this contracts ongoing with fixed price, fixed scope things ongoing. So how did this go?
Yeah, of course, we had this multi-million euro contract with an Indian partner for the next 6 years, working in fixed price model. So if you want to work in a collaborative approach, it doesn't really fit very well with your fixed price contract. So, and it takes time, of course. We find some loopholes in the contract, of course, to work in a more time and material based way. But still, it takes a couple of months before such a partner is fully in line with what you want. We have even sent some coaches to India to give some training on what we want to achieve. But still in the whole adoption process, well, I think it took 5 to 6 months before our partner was in line with what we wanted to do.
I still remember going to Pune in India, way too hot in summertime, by the way. So, okay, the contracts were changed so that that it allowed people to really do integrate into this agile organization. So, and that was a good thing. Within the agile organization, within IT, you started organizing teams towards more a product way of thinking. But the rest of the organization was still in a project way of thinking. So how did this go?
Well, it doesn't go very well, of course, because if you have an organization who are value-based and work in a more outcome-based way of working, it doesn't fit too well with a project mode of thinking. Also, if you work in Scrum, you work more in a pull model, while this project organization works in a push model. On the financial side, it's the same. The financial organization, they are still doing everything in projects. They make business cases on the basis of projects. But anyway, what we started to do is the product owners, they started us to think and to make their vision of their area. For instance, we had a fulfillment area where you attract new customers, which is outcome-based. You have an assurance area where you need to maintain existing customers. And around this area, you can really make a vision and try to work from this vision to implement everything what is surrounding, for instance, attracting new customers. So it's working well, but of course, it's not perfect if you have still a project organization.
Yeah, that was the idea. You still had this PM office or the project management office in order to translate this product vision that you now called. So that was being built up within the areas and surrounding the areas. And you had PMO still there to translate the things. But this didn't work very well, as you already mentioned. So why?
Well, if you look, for instance, to project managers, they are still kicking off projects. That means we are working in areas, outcome-based. We are trying to work with backlogs, doing refinements just in time. And then these project managers, they start to organize project kickoffs, which were not in line with what we wanted to do. So that gives, of course, a lot of tension between both organizations. And at certain moments, it even stops progressing the agile adoption. You're fighting under each other.
So that tension led to something that was called Bolt 2.0, where one of the aspects was indeed related to the tension that you just mentioned between the PMO projects versus product owners, or what you at that moment in time then start to understand as temporary fake area product owners.
Yeah, correct. And in fact, with all the senior people, we sat together and we said, if we want to continue with the change, we really need to do a second, let's say, Bolt 2.0. We called it then, where we really removed the project organization. And what we did is some people left the organization to took other roles within the organization, and other people we integrated in our what we called our value centers, like fulfillment or assurance. We moved these coordinators into the value center so that they can learn other skills in a multidisciplinary team, because coordinator, probably he can also do, for instance, some testing. And this stopped then. There was no fight anymore between these project managers and the value centers.
Yeah. But that was not the only thing. So you removed the complete project management office and project management as a methodology on top of the agile thing. And you gave more authority to the area product owners. So, but next to removing the PMO, you also removed something else.
Yeah, indeed. Because if you look to our organization, we were still in a hierarchical organization. We still have the middle management and the senior management, they were still there. So we decided, in fact, if you want to go to cross-disciplinary teams who take on their own responsibility, they don't need these managers. So we removed, in fact, the middle management to enforce the POs to take up more responsibility. And also the senior management, like me, for instance, I said, okay, I don't need to be head off anymore. We got more coaching assignments, coaching roles to try to steer the whole organization towards an agile adoption.
Which is pretty cool. So no, there is no project management, there is no line management. So there is product owners, scrum masters, team members. So how did you know what to work on as a coach and things like that? So that's where you also need to get this input still.
Yeah. And of course, it's a very chaotic moment. If you suddenly remove the complete hierarchy, it takes, of course, some time, but at a certain moment, you see people who are used to get direction from their managers. If these managers are not there anymore, then you really see that some people stand up and real improvements are coming from the bottom of the organization.
You really had this push on the button where people in the organization pushed work up. So instead of getting work pushed down the hierarchy, people were pushing work up in the hierarchy, which was called the improvement service or impediment service, as I remember. So, yeah, so it's great. So you get into this creative chaos. Does it also mean total chaos, Luke?
Sorry, I didn't understand you.
This creative chaos, does it also mean total chaos?
Well, it's a lot of chaos, because you eliminate two layers of management. So it's normal that you have a lot of chaos. And the chaos was even bigger than Bolt 1.0, because in Bolt 1.0, you still had a hierarchy and you still had the managers who could help. In Bolt 2.0, this hierarchy was gone. But what we saw, in fact, that the chaos was bigger, but they could cope much quicker with the change. That means you saw the chaos to settle down much quicker.
Okay, cool. So the huge changes were absorbed in the organization faster. That's what you mean, huh?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, but this was not the only thing, because now you talk about, we were KPN, you had KPN CIO Suzanne Kelder taking the sponsorship of this completing two bold moves, Bolt 1.0, Bolt 2.0, but at the same time, the acquisition to Telenet went through.
Yeah, indeed. And that came for us, of course, as a surprise, because we didn't know anything about it. And suddenly, while we are now doing a complete agile adoption in our IT organization, we were taken over by a very big company, Telenet, which has a very big IT organization. And suddenly, we are now part of an IT organization. Okay, we are only a small fish in this IT organization who, again, works in a very traditional way for the moment. That means in a waterfall model. So we were there with our small agile adoption. And of course, the first thing what these people want to do is, okay, we need to change the agile adoption back in our own process, which is a waterfall model.
Yeah, but you didn't go by it, and you didn't go into fights against it as well. You and the rest of the organization saw it as not as bad thing. You actually saw some big opportunities.
Indeed, because we still had a way to go. And for instance, we had several areas already in our agile adoption. We worked with several outcome areas, but we didn't have the overall backlog, which showed us a very nice planning of what and when we could deliver. So while these people were in fact busy taking us over, we saw in the next couple of months, we better prove to them that we are a well-oiled machine. And we still needed to build this overall backlog. So that's what we did.
In the meantime, this backlog has indeed been initialized and cleaned up and put into practice. That's one of the main reasons why Alexander is there already for the last 6 months, because he's very good at organizing the overall backlog and has a lot of good product owner capabilities in him and knows how to bring this to other people. So what's the benefit of having now this overall backlog in place?
Well, the overall backlog that we have put in place showed us, give us a long-term forecast. What will be delivered when overall for everything that consists of the mobile services, in fact. Because our IT, our organization, we were mobile-centric. We provided mobile services towards the business. So this backlog gives a mid- and long-term forecast on what will come when. And at the end, you saw that when we presented our way of working towards Telenet, that in fact, they were very interested in the way we worked, and they didn't want to kill it at the end.
So the forecasting was one part of the other part is that you gained an overall view of everything that is happening within the 300-400 plus people organization.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. So one part was the overall backlog and let's say the inbound of information into the agile organization, but there was also another thing. If you compare the base company organization to the Telenet organization, there were huge benefits in engineering practices.
Yeah, indeed. Because one of the things that you do, of course, if you're taking over, if a company takes another company over, you visit each other and you give, you show what you can do the best. So we also visited the Telenet IT organization, and what we saw it was that, in fact, in engineering practices, specifically in how they did their continuous integration, they automated testing, they were much better or further than we were. So in fact, we could also learn a lot from them. So we saw it not as a threat that to be taken over, but also we saw new opportunities, like we can learn from them and learn from their for instance, engineering practices which were better than ours.
Oh, cool. So this acquisition is there. You see opportunities. You work more on high impact things. At the same time, I can imagine, and I don't need to imagine, I was there. So Telenet is investigating the base company governance structure, way of working. So you have to show some benefits. So what were the biggest wins?
Well, of course, we did again, because then it was time for us also to do again this survey. but not now focused on a very specific area like data warehouse, but on the overall IT organization. And one of the things that came out of it is, for instance, that 80% of IT and business people, they didn't want to go back to the previous practices or the traditional way we worked. If you look also to the escalation and the blame culture of the past, in fact, that was gone because we were very transparent on what we are doing. There was no escalations anymore. So I think what we did was a true change in culture. And that was, in fact, something that Telenet, I think, they say, okay, there are some opportunities. We can also learn from this. And we are now still able to grow our agile adoption further and to make it better and better.
So because of those wins and the culture change, and for example, also the inquiry that showed that it was not only a feeling within IT or a couple of people, but really the organization as a whole, that gave you opportunities to actually broaden the scope. So as the elephant on the slide, there was no way back. Correct?
Indeed. They didn't want to kill our way of working. Of course, they have a traditional way of working and they embedded it in their overall way of working, but they didn't kill it.
Yeah. And as I understood, you can bring this kind of way of working into other parts within Telenet at this moment in time, correct?
That's correct, because we are initiating now new proof of concepts, in fact, to broaden our scope. So that means that we really have now some new opportunities to grow our adoption further.
So the life cycle repeats itself. So where you were end of 2014 is now again there in 2017.
Yeah, it's like a little start again. We still start from the beginning, doing a small proof of concept in the Telenet organization and start from there.
Okay, cool. So I think this is very normal in larger organizations that if some part of the organization did it successfully, that those people that were there from the starters will bring it to the rest of the organization. So pretty normal. Then again, you mentioned a couple of benefits, a couple of great things, that achievements that were done. If you have to pick one, just one, what would be the biggest win?
Well, the biggest win for the base company people with regards to the Telenet organization, the bigger Telenet organization, that is that we have gone already through a number of changes and we are in fact capable of taking any future change, whichever direction it goes, much better than the rest of the organization. So I think that's what we learned, to go through changes much faster.
So, which is a great thing, because the world is full of change and change is going faster than change itself. So if you are capable of absorbing change faster than any other organization, then you're there to survive. So cool. If you now, like, we are close to the end of the presentation, if you now need to give like your top three recommendations for our audience, what would they be?
Yeah, if I think about the first one is, if you try to do an agile adoption, you need to do it in a small area, deep and narrow. That's very important. So if you really turn the whole organization, but in a small area, and then what I would do is then do the next area and then do the next area, but first try to implement the whole process through a small independent area.
Okay, that's one. Let's go to number two.
Yeah, the second thing is what I learned is that there is also the rest of the organization. You have HR, you have the financial organization, and you certainly need to ensure that they are incorporated, because you suddenly go to a flat organization with self-steering teams, but it's HR is impacted. You don't have personal goals anymore. You work with common goals. A financial organization is usually they built around projects. You go away for project. You go away to more a fixed budget. So that's a huge change. So you need to ensure that you keep this organization also involved in the complete adoption process.
Okay, cool. And number three would be?
Yeah, I'm thinking what would be the best. Jürgen, you have an idea?
For me, it's like, okay, you say deep and narrow, you need to involve the whole organization. Number three, I don't know, it's for you. I saw a lot of, I can give a lot of tips, but it's for me, it's for you. Like, what would be the top three? Whatever pops in your mind.
Yeah. You need to, I think what's very important as the third one is that you need to have enough support from the top. Because if the top management is not really behind this complete adoption, it's very difficult to do it. So you can do things from the bottom, but also you need to have support from the top. It's much easier, I would say.
And I would add not only support from the top, it's only support from the top. They don't need to mingle into the adoption itself. They just need to support it.
Yeah, indeed. Correct.
But then again, that's the experience we had at Base Company. It's always context dependent. So cool. If you now say, okay, we did this kind of large-scale Scrum adoption. So along the way, you discovered that it was the complete agile adoption was more large-scale Scrum, less based as a basic framework. So how less are you at the moment?
Well, I think, Jürgen, since I think you can better answer this question. So how less are we? So I give the word to you.
Thank you, Luke. If I think how less is Base Company or the this part within Telenet, because it's all Telenet now, then I would say there are you're already did a long way, but you're definitely not there yet. And the things that would be missing or that are not according to the lesser rules, let's put it like this, would be the co-location and small teams. So less is saying in the rules we need co-location and small teams, and some of the teams are still distributed and are bigger than small, and there's a good reason behind that. So I think the main reason there is skills that needs to be transferred from one person to another person so that everybody can do some of the work. And as soon as skills has been transferred through the people well enough, then most probably this big will be good enough to split into a Pune team and a Brussels team, so that we don't have big teams anymore and that need this co-location in there. Another thing, but that's something when we did this kind of presentation, I think at XP Days, December, I could still say, okay, we don't have an overall product owner. Today, I cannot say this anymore. At that conference, you promised that there would be an overall product owner, and we have an overall product owner at this moment. So this is gone. So that's great. And I think the one that will take the most time is the cleaning up the technical debt that was occurred along the way. So there's still a lot of technical debt to clean up to make sure that you can actually really deliver finished products every iteration. So there's still quite some undone work to do after the iteration. And that's where I think, like, okay, where it's not completely less yet. And again, less is designing for perfection. So it gives you the drive to continuously improve, doesn't it? Luc?
Yes, correct.
So there's quite some things to go there. So with this, I think we end the presentation time, and then we have a slide for Q&A, but I will stop the screen sharing, or Alexander can take it over again. So thanks already for listening, and we are eager to see what kind of questions you have.